inside war-torn South Sudan, where millions are fleeing for their lives and thousands more are dying of starvation.
It is a cesspool of human suffering.
And then,
survival of the fittest.
A former lost boy who's now running for a different reason.
Not for me, it's for them. I'm carrying this flag.
On today's 700 Club.
Well, welcome to the 700 Club. Technology is a key part of our lives today. And yesterday, we saw what happens when it fails. The New York Stock Exchange, United Airlines, and the Wall Street Journal all went down at the same time.
It's raising questions about our growing dependence on computers and technology and the possible security problems that could cause major disruptions in our modern world. Caitlin Burke has the story.
In only an instant, the New York Stock Exchange ground to a halt, shut down for more than 3 hours Wednesday because of a technical glitch.
Obviously, it's a little bit unnerving just in the sense it reminds us of the vulnerability of this interlinked system. It used to be we used to trade with pads and paper.
The same day, air travel at a standstill for more than 2 hours when a United Airlines computer malfunction prevented communication with all planes on the ground. Across the country, more than 800 flights delayed, 59 canceled.
This is system-wide. This computer failure is throughout the United system, which means nobody's going nowhere.
Think of all the critical systems we rely on every day that are controlled by technology. Electricity grids, lines of communication, financial markets. Experts warn that as technology surges forward, we need to make sure that security measures are in place to protect it.
In 2012, there was the flash crash when a technical glitch caused the Dow to plunge 500 points in, or 600 points in 5 minutes. Also on the NASDAQ exchange, the Facebook IPO was botched because of a technical issue. So we have seen software problems and technical problems mucking up trading before.
A domino effect may have contributed to an additional outage at the Wall Street Journal. Some speculating that the newspaper's website buckled after the New York Stock Exchange problems caused alarmed investors to swamp the site. Wednesday's outages appear to have been a fluke, the White House announcing that the FBI has ruled out sabotage.
What I can tell you is that as it relates to at least the New York Stock Exchange and United Airlines, that there's no indication at this point of any sort of malicious activity being responsible for the technical issues that they've endured today.
Still, a jolting reminder about our deepening dependence on technology and the need for protections against not only intruders, but glitches. Caitlin Burke, CBN News.
Well, we have a remarkably fragile system, and if you think we can go back to paper and pencil in today's world, we're not going to do that. It's just a reminder of how fragile these systems are and how when they break, everything shuts down. Well, in other news, the head of the Democratic National Committee is weighing in on the controversy of gay rights and religious freedom. John Jessup has that story from our CBN News Bureau in Washington. John?
Thanks, Gordon. Debbie Wasserman Schultz tells CBN News churches have far greater religious liberty rights than those of private business owners. She sat down with CBN's David Brody to discuss the religious liberty issue after a state official in Oregon ordered a Christian business to pay a lesbian couple $135,000 because it wouldn't bake a cake for their same-sex wedding. The DNC chairwoman says a distinction must be made between churches and private citizens running a business.
If you're a religiously affiliated organization, then you have wider latitude in terms of the Constitution and the protections that our First Amendment provides. But I think Americans make a distinction between protecting the First Amendment rights of a religious organization or a religiously affiliated organization and being able to discriminate broadly simply because of one individual who owns a business and their own values and their being able to impose those values on either their employees or their customers.
You can see more of this interview at David Brody's blog at The Brody File on CBNNews.com. Well, while emotions sizzle in the wake of the Supreme Court's ruling on same-sex marriage, the pro-family movement earned a big win at the United Nations. The UN Human Rights Council adopted a resolution protecting and reaffirming the family, saying the family is the natural and fundamental group unit of society. The Center for Family and Human Rights reports that it's a monumental development calling for countries to take concrete steps to protect the family and to adopt family-friendly laws and policies. 14 countries, including the United States, the UK, and several other European nations, voted against it. Much of the opposition stems from gay rights supporters who believe the resolution lays the foundation for opposing LGBT rights under international law. That's because the resolution doesn't explicitly define family, and efforts to pass amendments with inclusive language highlighting diversity among families failed. The South Carolina House has approved a bill to take down the Confederate flag from the state capitol grounds. The move came after more than 13 hours of passionate debate.
Just to say that I never fully realized just how offensive the Confederate battle flag was to you and other African Americans in our state.
Wednesday's vote is in response to the fatal shootings of 9 black church members, including a state senator, at a Bible study at a historic church in Charleston. The state Senate already approved the bill. It now goes to Governor Nikki Haley, who supports the flag's removal, and it could come down within days. Meanwhile, state police are investigating an unspecified number of threats against South Carolina lawmakers debating the flag. Boko Haram terrorists in Nigeria are offering to free more than 200 kidnapped girls in exchange for the release of militant leaders in government custody. The mostly Christian girls were abducted from a boarding school last year, igniting a worldwide Bring Back Our Girls campaign. Boko Haram later promised the girls would never be seen again unless Nigeria's government released more than a dozen Boko Haram detainees. Negotiations are underway with Nigeria's new president, who's been in office for 5 weeks. The director of the FBI is warning that ISIS is trying to recruit members over the internet and then sending messages telling new recruits to kill. James Comey says ISIS has about 21,000 English language followers on Twitter in Syria. He says ISIS is trying to recruit new members and once they respond, sends them encrypted messages. The FBI is asking Silicon Valley to help break that encryption technology. The Islamic radicals encourage the potential recruits to come join their caliphate, and if they can't, ISIS has another message for them.
If you can't come, kill somebody where you are. Kill somebody in uniform, kill anybody. If you can cut their head off, great, videotape it. Do it, do it, do it. They're pushing this through Twitter. So it's no longer the case that someone who's troubled needs to go find this propaganda and this motivation. It buzzes in their pocket. So there is a device, almost a devil on their shoulder all day long saying, kill, 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 kill.
And Gordon, we already know ISIS is a threatening enemy.
We do, but at the same time, I wonder why we should give up this kind of privacy. I'm all for government protecting us from terrorism, but at the same time, who's going to protect us from government? And right now, we've got a wonderful government, but we've seen in history that those wonderful governments can sometimes turn against their own people. And when they have the ability to know everything about you, right down to the books you read on Kindle, the songs you listen to on iTunes, and then they're asking for these back doors into any encryption technology so they can monitor all the messages, all the emails, all that you're doing, that gives me pause. I don't want governments to have that kind of authority or that kind of knowledge. And I think in the pursuit of some illusion that will increase our security, when we give up that power to our governments, that they get to scrutinize every little detail of any individual's life, that's an invasion of privacy that I don't think we should have in a free and open society. Terry?
Well, coming up, it's the world's newest nation and also one of the most unstable.
This country has been one of the neediest countries in the world. It is a cesspool of human suffering.
Meet the people trying to end that suffering. That's coming up next.
Well, 4 years ago today, South Sudan became an independent nation. And that independence was supposed to end decades of fighting. Many hoped peace would finally take hold, but that hasn't happened. As George Thomas discovered, war has again gripped this new country, leaving thousands of people dead and millions displaced.
These are images from that jubilant day on July 9th, 2011, when South Sudan became a new nation. But the celebrations were short-lived.
We never imagined our country would turn out this way.
During the time of independence, there was so much hope and enthusiasm about the prospects of South Sudan moving forward. Years later, this country is engulfed in civil war.
The fighting started in the capital, Juba, in December 2013 after the president accused his vice president of an attempted coup. Soldiers loyal to both men turned on each other. Since then, war has engulfed seven of the country's 10 provinces.
Too many people are getting killed.
So many, including small children.
Yeah. How do you feel about
women?
This? Tell me, how do you feel?
No, it's really very bad. I feel sorry as a Southern.
In four short years, South Sudan went from the world's newest country to its most fragile.
This country has been one of the neediest countries in the world. It is a cesspool of human suffering.
And I wondered if I might close with just a quick prayer.
Rich Stearns is president of World Vision U.S. His group has been working in South Sudan since 1989. Stearns says the war is leaving a trail of tears and unspeakable human suffering.
It is a terrible place to be a child, a terrible place to be a family in so many ways, because there are so many different threats to your livelihood and your well-being, whether it's food or lack of clean water, lack of sanitary facilities, lack of educational opportunities, lack of economic development, or conflict, as we've seen right now is happening in this country.
Violence committed by both sides is intensifying. The UN says hundreds of girls as young as eight have been gang raped and murdered. Boys have been castrated and left to bleed to death. Last week, UN investigators accused South Sudanese government soldiers of raping scores of women and girls, then burning them alive.
Well, the spirit of the Independence Day was the spirit of peace. The spirit today is the spirit of conflict.
People aren't working, farmers aren't planting. 2 million people have fled their homes. Many have escaped to neighboring countries. Others live in the bush or swamps.
It's been very disheartening to see the potentially bright future of this brand new country be put on hold.
Meanwhile, tens of thousands have sought protection in UN-run camps like this one on the outskirts of the capital city.
Since the conflict began back in December 2013, the United Nations is now running these POC. They're called Protection of Civilian Sites. This one has roughly about 22,000, but across the eight sites, there are close to about 130,000 South Sudanese.
Ariane Quentier of the UN says that number is just the tip of the iceberg.
Because we probably have something like 3 million people between refugees and displaced persons who have been affected by this war.
World Vision oversees food distribution at the camp. Ngure Muruti heads the operation and says his team ensures that no one slips through the cracks without food.
They get sorghum, they get beans, they get vegetable oil, and they get salt.
Mary Namon has lived in the camp for nearly 2 years.
I have no other option but to stay here until this war ends.
She's lucky to even have food to eat. Far from the camp, in towns and villages in the war zone, people are dying of starvation. And reaching those in desperate need can be logistically challenging.
Here's a staggering fact for you. South Sudan is roughly the size of the state of Texas, and there are only 200 miles of paved tarmac. So the best way to get to these locations is via plane.
On a recent afternoon,
sir, one at a time.
One at a time, yep, sure. Thank you, sir.
CBN News joined World Vision as they traveled to a remote village far from the capital city. Here, aid workers race frantically to save a quarter of a million children like Aout, who are suffering from severe malnutrition.
One of the things they do right away is to get an assessment, a physical assessment, but also a weight assessment. Aoud is 13 months old, and a typical child at 13 months should weigh roughly about 9 kilograms. Aoud right now at 13 months weighs about 5.5.
Nurse Damaris Wanjiku says a combination of therapeutic milk and nutrient-rich foods will keep him and other kids in this village alive.
The mothers go home with the children, then they return every 7 days. Mm-hmm. And then we take their weight just to monitor the progress, mm-hmm. and then we give them more supplies for another week.
The program continues until each child is healthy.
My baby would be dead if it wasn't for this nutritional center. Thank God he's getting better every day.
A glimmer of hope in a young nation spiraling out of control. Despite several attempts at peace, both sides are unwilling to compromise and silence their guns. So for now, the fighting rages on, with tens of thousands dead and no end in sight. For aid groups, it's a battle against the odds to save lives, as experts warn of a catastrophic famine that could affect up to 5 million people. George Thomas, CBN News, South Sudan.
Your heart just goes out to the people and the children and the devastation that's happening. So pray for peace in South Sudan. This war is decades old. You can even go back 100 years and you find Sudan racked in war. It just doesn't ever seem to leave. And we need to pray for the peace of southern Sudan. Terry?
Well, up next, the story of a former Sudanese lost boy who ran from a refugee camp and right into Olympic glory.
God put us here for the reason and put me here to survive all these obstacles that I went through for the reason. Basically, to go out and help.
Lopez Lomong tells us why he's running for two countries. That's next.
We just showed you a story of the horror going on in South Sudan. And now we want to show you a story of what can happen when they get free, when they get free from all that war. And they're amazing people. Well, distance runners know you need a ton of stamina and mental strength to make it to the finish line. And for American now, American star track Lopez Lomong, those are two skills he developed while living in a Sudanese refugee camp. Tom Buring has his story.
I'm running this race, not for me, it's for them. I'm carrying this flag. I'm running for the children that don't have even moms, don't have parents, don't have anybody to take care of them, to clothe them, to feed them if they're hungry, to give them a shoe. I am running for those kids, for those parents who are like, never have an opportunity to come here.
Lopez Lomong was born in a small village in Sudan. When he was 6, rebels snatched him from his mother's arms during a church service.
I was dragged by a big guy with a lot of guns and bullets around him and was thrown in a truck.
He was imprisoned at a rebel camp where he watched other young captives die. That's when he and three other boys planned their escape.
They told me like, hey, tonight we are going to see your mom again.
In the dead of the night, Lopez slipped through a prison fence and ran for his life.
We're trying to like run into the woods, through the savannah, in a tall grass, things like that, because we don't want anybody to be able to see us on above, on the hills and all these things. And we never had any food along the way. We just have fruits.
3 days and 40 miles later, the Kenyan Border Patrol found little Lopez and took him to a refugee camp. It was his home for the next 10 years. His new enemies became disease, hunger, and despair.
How often were you afraid that you were going to lose your life?
I wanted to be, you know, one of those kids who just goes to sleep and never wake up. It's a survival of the fittest. You know, you have to be strong. You have to be to be able to get that half peel of banana or expired canned food. And we all fighting for that. And that was our life. I'm just going to go day by day, hour by hour, and I know that God is going to give me an opportunity. And that's basically what I make me keep going.
Lopez attended church services. He longed for a deeper relationship with God and wanted to be baptized. During a Christmas Eve service, he made a commitment to live like Jesus.
I've been chosen, mm-hmm. and God wanted me to carry that cross and follow him. And how Jesus appointed his disciples, called them by name. And that's why I'm doing the God work.
He began running the 18-mile perimeter of the refugee camp to meet the kids' self-imposed requirement to play in their soccer games. It served as a distraction.
It basically kept me away from thinking about my meal. And I mean, it's very tough to see that little rationing that you know that it's only you have to eat one meal a day. So running became something like I have to keep myself away from hunger.
When Lopez turned 16, a remarkable opportunity opened. He was among 3,800 displaced kids chosen to live with families in the United States. Robert and Barbara Rogers became Lopez's American parents as part of the Lost Boys of Sudan program.
I'm so blessed to be in this country. Me and my mom went to shop for school supplies, to have that backpack, to have that pencil, crayons in my backpack at 16 years old, so that I can be able to write something I remember afterward. It's just incredible.
Lopez graduated from high school in nearby Tully, New York, where he ran on the track team. He earned a scholarship to Northern Arizona University and became an American citizen. He qualified for the 2008 Olympics in the men's 1500 meters and carried the U.S. flag in the opening ceremonies. Lopez won his first national title a year later at the 2009 USA Outdoor Track and Field Championships. He competes year-round internationally, never forgetting the thousands of remaining lost boys of Sudan still searching for homes.
Now I'm running towards something. I'm running towards something to be able to give back to those kids, to give them opportunity, to give them that light for them, a future. You went to the United States and you told your story. Basically, now you rescued all of us. God put us here for the reason and put me here to survive all these obstacles that I went through for the reason. Basically, to go out and help.
Lopez lives and trains in Portland, Oregon. He authored the book, Running for My Life, to raise awareness of the plight of displaced children in southern Sudan.
Put everything in God's hand and follow what your heart and God relationship tells you to do. We all have different things that go through our lives. We're all racing in our hearts in different ways. We all have things that we need to overcome. You just have to like step on that line and race. Get there and call God and say, hey, I'm here. Save me, forgive me. That's the race that we all need to do.
Lopez won at the 2014 USA Indoor Championships and is training for the 2016 Olympics in Rio de Janeiro.
The Olympic 5K runs 12 and a half laps. In the first six, runners share pacing and positioning. The next four require perseverance. But it's in Lopez's last lap and a half when he prepares to strike. Then, in the final straightaway stretch, the focus is his alone.
Oh God, help me. Just give me one more strike. 80 meters to go, and then you strike. Strike hard. Basically, that's when you just get and say, hey, I'm doing this for joy. I'm just doing this for God. I'm doing for everything that means so much to me. I'm running, closing my eyes, visualizing everything that how I went through. Running away from people, like rocks, sticks, sticking on my, breaking into my skin while I was running barefoot with my Sunday best clothes that I had. Jesus did save me. And Jesus did help me with my race. I'm not in the finish line yet. I'm just in the middle of the race.
What a wonderful story. What a transformation. And what a story of hope for today. Just imagine his life and growing up and being able to say, I got out of that. I found a way out. And through that, what amazing things happen. Terry, it's just all the power of, believing in God. But then God had this wonderful couple appointed to say, we'll take him, we'll raise him, we'll bring him up.
Yeah, some of the stories that have been told of lost boys who've come to the United States are just remarkable, not just what they struggled with in their country, but coming here and having no idea how to function or how things worked, and yet not just surviving, but thriving. It's a story of real
and overcoming.
Yes.
And you look at that and you say, let's pray for Sudan. What can happen to that people if they finally have peace? How could things be so transformed that that same story could happen in Sudan, not in the United States, but in Sudan? So pray for that. Remember to pray for Sudan. Pray for the peace there. And let's see this through. We can overcome all things. With Christ, we can do it. Just as he overcame, we can persevere here, and we can see an answer come.
Well, coming up later, we're going to answer your email questions. Ivan says, I just became a Christian. My family practices Buddhism, and they pray to an idol in our house. What should I do? Gordon shares his thoughts on that question and more. That's later on today's show.
And welcome back to the 700 Club. An Ohio judge is seeking an exemption from performing same-sex marriages. Toledo Municipal Court Judge C. Allen McConnell cited his personal and religious beliefs when he refused to marry a gay couple earlier this week. In a statement, he said, quote, I apologize to the couple for the delay they experienced and wish them the best. McConnell will continue to perform weddings between men and women while he awaits a decision. His request will go before a conduct and ethics board. A group of atheists is trying to get rid of a 6-foot statue known as Big Mountain Jesus. A panel of 3 judges will decide its fate. The atheists asked for it to be removed from the U.S. Forest Service property in Montana. A federal district judge said back in 2013 that the Flathead National Forest could let the statue stay by reissuing a 10-year permit. The statue has been there since 1954. The atheists say the statue violates the separation of church and state, but the Justice Department says the statue has historical significance in the area and that the Forest Service is not endorsing a religion. And you can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com. Gordon and Terry will be back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
Well, the hope is coming July 20th on this program, the 700 Club. It'll be an 8-part series beginning July 20th. It'll all be available online, but watch the show, and we'll also have a DVD available if you want to watch it again and again. I think it's very important for people to understand the history, the modern history of how the State of Israel came into existence in 1948. So we've put together a documentary for you. It's biographical. We tell the stories of the people who were involved, what influenced them, what inspired them, how did they believe for what was then seemingly impossible that Israel could ever come into existence. You need to understand the history in order to understand today's headlines and the current debate going on about the West Bank, the Gaza Strip. What is the source of the conflict with the Palestinians? How long has that been going on? That's not something new. That goes back over 100 years. So get informed, watch the program. You can see it online. You can also get the DVD. It all starts here on July 20. Now we've got some time for some questions.
And we do. Let's bring it on. Okay, this is Ivan who says, what should I do if I live in a family of Buddhists? I have just converted to Christianity and don't know what to do. My family prays to the idol in our home.
Ivan, use your opportunity to witness to them the change in you. And I wouldn't be worried about idols. If you're worried about the idols, go back and read the story of what Elijah did to some idols and the prophets of Baal. If they believe that a blind idol, a deaf and dumb idol can do anything, they're mistaken. So you pray to the living God, the one who is in your heart now, and ask him to change the hearts of your family and realize that Christ is in you. And with him, you can do all things. And when you have that confidence going forward, no idol can stand against you. No prayer to that idol can stand against you. And you just conquer in love. Do it peacefully. Do it with love. But let the witness of what Jesus is doing for you, how he's changing you, change your family.
Okay, this is Darla who says, the Bible tells us what's going to happen in the last days, and I believe we're seeing it happen now. If the Bible tells us what's going to happen, why should and why do Christians pray against what's happening? Isn't it prophecy being fulfilled?
Darla, you're right into the old spectrum, if you will, of God's sovereignty, predestination, Calvinism.
To name a few.
and you know, should we literally do anything? Because it's all already mapped out. I'll give you an extreme of that argument. That argument was used with William Carey. Here he is in 1795. He's a cobbler in England, and he gets the idea that God really wants us to preach the gospel, and he wants us to go to the heathen, that's what they called them back then, and preach the gospel. Let people who live in darkness know the good news. And a minister rose against him and said, when God wants to convert the heathen, he knows how to do it. And the amazing thing to me is God wants to use us. Now, what does that mean? How does that work out? And how does that work out in terms of biblical prophecy? Well, one of the great prophecies about the end times is this gospel of the kingdom will be preached as a witness in all the world. That means every nation, every tongue, every tribe gets a chance to hear the good news. Now, God didn't ask the angels to do that. If I were God, I think I'd ask the angels to do it. I think they would have done a better job. But he's asked you and me to do that. And the incredible thing is he has the faith to believe that we'll do it, that we won't shrink back from it. And no matter how hard the territory is, whether it's in some radical Islamic country or right next door to our neighbor, that we have the ability to preach the gospel. And in that, the Apostle Peter says, hasten the coming of the day of the Lord. That's how we get to do it. So it's up to us to bring that. Prophecy is conditional. It's up to us to fulfill what he's asked us to do. So pray about that. How can you be a part of God's plan? How does he want you? What special things has he created for you to walk into to be part of his plan? And don't worry about the sort of esoteric side of it. Just say, very practically, God, what do you want me to do? And what do you want me to do today? And then when he tells you that, go and do it. We've got time, I think, for one more. I'm going to take time for one more. We've got a question for Terry, and this one's come in for you. Way back, I believe the Lord was whispering to me about foster care. Apparently, it's not just way back. It still is. I just want to give a child a family with love that is safe no matter what they do. I'm 54 years old. I have 2 grown children and 5 grandchildren who all live out of state. My question is, how does this work? Where do I begin? Terry, you seem to have lots of experience with children. Could you give me some advice?
Well, first of all, I just want to say, yay, Sharon, go, go. There are almost 500,000 children in foster care in America, and all of them need homes. And so kudos to you for being willing to open your heart and your home. I would suggest that you contact an agency that deals with adoption and foster care. We have used Bethany as an agency with our family, and they're awesome. Also, Lutheran Social Services, there are many of them. And find out
about the process. It may be different in your area, but I would suggest that you find out about it and also all the things you need to know. Orphans Promise has a DVD that I would suggest that you get too. Happy to send you one if you contact me. It's called Adoption and Foster RX, meant to help you understand some of the behaviors you might run into, how to walk through them, and how to walk with a child to healing and wholeness. So we'd love to have you move forward with this and be a helping hand to you in the process. If you get a hold of me, I'll send you one. Well, that's all the time we have for Bring It On today, but we want to share something else with you now. Paul Treloar served his country well, and when he left the Corps, he and his wife wanted to help others. But when the money ran tight, this couple needed someone to help them.
Marine Corps Sergeant Paul Treloar knows firsthand what it's like to serve on the front lines in Afghanistan and Iraq. During his 8 years of service, he remembers leaving his family behind was always tough. When deployed, he relied on his wife, Jenny, to keep the family connected.
Where'd she go?
Though I wasn't there, she kept videos and she'd email me. She is amazing. I couldn't do a lot of the stuff that she's done. She's been the best thing that God's put in my life.
You do what you have to do. I wasn't doing it to be amazing, I was doing it because it needed to be done.
Paul left the Corps when the couple felt God calling them to missions full time. Then they discovered living in the mission field would take more money and training than they first thought. They postponed their plan, which left Paul scrambling for a job.
It was really a shock and really frightening because, you know, I've got a wife and three kids to take care of. We knew it was going to be a huge trial for us. It's not going to be fun, it's not going to be easy, but God will provide.
The Treloar's pastor, Bobby Oliveri, asked CBN's Helping the Homefront to assist the family. CBN was honored to help.
I'm really overcome by a sense of gratitude and thankfulness that there are partners willing to come beside and do things that smaller churches aren't able to do.
Pastor Bobby went to their home and told the couple Helping the Homefront would pay 3 months of car payments and rent while Paul looked for a job.
Wow, 3 months of no rent, that's amazing. Rent is a huge, huge part of our budget.
A few months later, Paul landed a job with the local power company. He's also pursuing his training for the mission field. The Treloar say Helping the Homefront helped them through their crisis.
It is such a blessing that CBN could find us through our local church, that a big corporation could partner up with the local where the people really are.
It's very reassuring, that God will provide. If you are truly in line with His will, we thank CBN and our church so much for providing for us and, you know, doing God's work.
Helping the Homefront, that's just one of the programs that you support when you become a part of the 700 Club. And you know, we love working with the local church. Hand in hand, we all reach out to make a difference in the lives of people in need, people who want to do something good in this scenario for others and just need a little help over a hump in their lives at the moment. And you can be a part of this and so much more around the world. Join the 700 Club. It's 65 cents a day, $20 a month. You'll be joining with thousands of people who really are out to make a difference and are making a difference. And that's why we love to show you these stories on our program, so you can see that your hand is touching lives all around the globe. How do you join the 700 Club? You call the toll-free number on your screen, 1-800-759-0700. Just say you want to join. And when you do, our gift to say thank you to you for caring about others is Pat's latest, The Transforming Word. This is a DVD and a CD teaching about healing and wholeness and verses for health and healing. We want you to have this. It's our way of saying thank you for caring, and you'll have the satisfaction of knowing you're making a difference. Well, up next, a mom with a choice. Call her son or take her life.
I was just in a very, very dark place, and unfortunately, my children were the ones that had to suffer.
Find out what happened next when we return.
To see this week's most viewed stories, go to CBN.com.
These days, Sylvia Marchio helps former drug addicts, prostitutes, and alcoholics. There's a reason she understands their plight, because not too long ago, she was one of them.
My dad did say, "You'll never amount to a hill of beans." And that sentence just right there crushed my spirit.
Sylvia Marshiel heard few kind words from her father. And while he was an alcoholic and verbally abusive, her mother was emotionally detached. It left Sylvia feeling empty and alone.
I got absolutely no emotional support from my parents. I just felt that my dad hated me and disapproved of everything I did, and it was devastating.
As Sylvia got older, she looked to boys for affirmation.
I saw my life just reaching out to whoever that paid attention to me and that loved me.
Hoping to start a normal life, she married a man she knew from high school, but there were problems from the very beginning.
He was an alcoholic, and as a pattern, living with an alcoholic, being raised by one, it was the norm for me to marry one.
He wasn't abusive, but had little to do with Sylvia or their growing family.
He wasn't there, and I didn't know what I was doing. I just felt very, very alone and very afraid.
After their second son was born, he distanced himself even more, and they separated. At 28, Sylvia moved in with her parents, and the couple shared custody of the boys. But as her parents watched her sons, Sylvia started going to bars, where she was introduced to cocaine.
I fell in love with it, and I was able to self-medicate and numb the pain that I'd felt for so many years and from the failure of my marriage.
Sylvia's new lifestyle quickly took a hold of her, and she partied constantly. As a result, her ex-husband took full custody of their sons.
I emotionally was a wreck. I was just in a very, very dark place. And unfortunately, my children were the ones that had to suffer.
Sylvia started bartending and eventually got hooked on crack. As the addiction got worse, she turned to the streets, doing whatever she needed to do to stay high.
I prostituted. I sold my body. I stole from my family. I was very scandalous, and I found myself being arrested on 3 or 4 different occasions.
Later, both her parents passed away. But before her father died, he told her something she had wanted to hear her entire life.
Right before he died, he did tell me that he loved me. The only time he ever told me. I promised him time after time that I would stop. He goes, "I don't want to live if you're not going to live." And I'll try.
But as much as she tried, she couldn't keep that promise. Things got even worse when she received a final gift from her parents.
I inherited a lot of money, about $130,000. And I even had money put in a CD for my kids. I was going to do it the right way. I was going to get clean and sober, and that never happened. I ended up spending the whole amount in 8 months. It was gone.
As the years passed and the addiction ravaged her body, Sylvia had lost all hope and considered suicide. In her desperation, she reached out to Kevin, her son who had become a Christian.
I figured I'm going to take my life, or I'm going to put this quarter in the payphone and pray that my son, Kevin, answers the phone. And he did. And I told him, I said, I've lost everything, Kevin. I've spent it all. And I just want to die. Or will you help me? I need help. He said, "I'm going to find a home for you. You need to go into rehab." And I said, "I'll do anything."
He took her to the Walter Hoving Home in Pasadena, a Bible-based recovery home for women. There, they met John and Elsie Benton, founders of the ministry.
The person had no hope, you know, and I don't think she felt that she could change.
As we call her, Mom B was there. She prayed with me, and I sobbed uncontrollably, and I accepted the Lord as Jesus as my Savior. Right then, without even having read the Bible, I hadn't read the Bible. I didn't care. I knew that there was only one way that I was going to get help, and that was to look up to Jesus.
Sylvia says she never suffered withdrawals, and though it wasn't always easy, she finished the program and learned who she was in God.
as I grew in the Walter Hoving home and learned who Christ was in me, and just everything in Scripture, I began to thirst for more of it.
Mom and Dad Benton showed her a love she never thought was possible.
I was starving for affection. I was starving for love. I had been denied that all my life, and the Bentons loved me unconditionally.
When they come to know Jesus Christ as their Savior, and that relationship helps them to overcome their past, and it's amazing what God does with these ladies.
Sylvia also learned to love herself.
We'd all been through something where we felt that we were not worthy of forgiveness, but with Jesus, He forgave me for all of it. And so through time, I was able to forgive myself.
Today, Sylvia is the vice president and director of the Walter Hoving Home in Las Vegas.
I look in the mirror sometimes and just am in awe of what God has done, what Jesus has done in my life, and how He's completely renewed my mind. He's transformed my life.
And that's what the Word, God's Word, His love letter to us, the Bible tells us, that we need a transformation, a renewing of our mind. We need the Spirit of God to come in and give us a new name. And He says He does that, and He carves our name on the palm of His hand. He doesn't see us in the state that we're in. He sees us through the shed blood of Jesus Christ, through the transforming resurrection power of His Son. And it's available to each and every one of us. So today, if you're struggling, if there are things in your life that you feel like you just can't overcome, come to the place that Sylvia did. You know, you're right, you can't. I can't, you can't. It's why we need a Savior. It's why there's power in the salvation of Christ. There's power in His name, there's power in the Word, and it's yours for the taking. Today, if you find yourself trapped in a place of your own making, or because someone like Sylvia's dad did to her early on has told you that you're worthless or called you by a name that's stuck with you and made you feel like that's who you is, who you are, you can transform your mind today. You can have a new beginning. You can have a new name. Jesus wants to touch your life. And that thing you feel inside of you right now in watching her story is that hunger and thirst and longing that Sylvia talked about. Come to the Lord. Despite the people who've done you wrong, the people who have many instances passed on and aren't even here, but have left you in the wake of all of that, you can have a new beginning today. Be defined by the One who loved you enough to die for you and who says this, "I'll never leave you or forsake you." He wants to love you today. He wants you to know Him. He's always there for the asking. If you'd like to pray with someone about a need in your life today, if you'd like to invite Jesus to be the Lord and Savior of your life, just like Sylvia talked about doing, call the toll-free number on your screen. The friend who answers the phone on the other end of that line receives you with joy. They're waiting to hear from you. There's no judgment, no condemnation. There's nothing you're going to tell them they haven't heard before. But they would love for you today to find the same freedom they have in the love and forgiveness of Jesus Christ. 1-800-759-0700 is the number to call. Please call now. We want to leave you today with this word. It's from Proverbs 1, verse 33. "Whoever listens to me will dwell safely and will be secure without fear of evil." That's the word of God for you today. Thank you so much for joining us. We'll be back with more of the 700 Club tomorrow. God bless you. Have a great day.